name is Steffen, and I have today the honor to guide you through these topics. Maybe we can start with the
Our air's gone from the world's cleanest to the dirtiest in only one generation.
Sometimes you just put a sheet of paper in front of you and imagine all that is beautiful.
So as you can see, the time for change is now. Our urban spaces are massively influenced by the buildings we are all creating. And over the buildings we are influenced in our daily life. Doesn't matter if you're thinking on shopping, living, working, relaxing. This is urban life. And nevertheless, the building sector was not yet so clear on the screen of sustainability. If we carry on like this, we all know at the moment, or we do not exactly know where it will happen, but we have seen it in the ocean, we see it in the cities, it's getting hotter, flooding. And if we have a look in the building sector, then it's awful if you look at the waste generation. Even in Europe, over 50% of the generated waste comes out of the building sector. 38% of the CO2 consumption worldwide comes also out from the building sector. So if we compare that to other sectors, we have a long way to go. And the time for that is now. So meet the speakers together with me. And yeah, we will see what they will bring in to this topic. So, first I would like to welcome Christin. Christin Schneider is the lead of CRE Innovations, the corporate real estate sector of Zalando SE. She's working with Zalando since 2017, and she's responsible for all the new stuff, I would say, digitization, sustainability, and change management as well. Before Zalando, she has been working 5 years at the University of Duisburg-Essen, and even there, we will see that later with the other speakers, developed models for car sharing and also climate protection. Christin, stay.
Thanks a lot for your kind introduction. So today I would like to give you a brief overview on how we approach sustainability at Zalando and how we use technology to do so. So I think the most of you already know Zalando. We're bringing fashion to 20 countries across Europe and have more than 4,000 brands on our platform. But we also recognized if everybody in the world would consume just the average in Europe, we would like 2.8 planets for that. So our vision at Zalando is to be a sustainable fashion platform with a net positive impact for people and the planet. So less bad is not good enough for us. So we want to go further and include the whole value chain. So for example, we committed ourselves with the science-based targets to reduce our carbon footprint by 80% by 2025. And we already achieved a lot of things in the last year. So what's essential here that we have the broad picture. So we're always challenging the three pillars, planet, product, as well as people. But let's dive a little bit deeper into real estate then. In alignment with our Do More sustainability strategy to reduce carbon footprint as well as CO2 neutral operations, we already achieved a lot of things. So for example, with our on-site energy production on our warehouses, we're already saving more than 5,500 tons per year in CO2. This is equivalent round about 200 Earth orbits with a 40 tons truck. And where our approach is to go step by step. So we're implementing different technologies such as ice storage, geothermal, or general battery storages, and then we test it, and if it's successful, we roll it out to all the sites where it's feasible. As I mentioned earlier, technology is our key to fulfill our ambitious goals as well. So, started with a BIM implementation, we in our warehouses to then lead to energy simulations, as well as digital twins to generate more efficiency. So for all those who are not familiar with it, BIM means building information modeling and is the key to understand buildings. It's on a 3D-based model and helps us to design, plan, construct, as well as operate our buildings in an efficient way. So for us at Zalando, our aim is to approach BIM along the entire life cycle as a methodology to achieve all the efficiencies. So just I want to give you a broad overview. What do we have already in place? So we started with clash detection. As you can imagine, such big warehouses, there are a lot of stakeholders involved. And our approach is to build the building upfront in a digital way to avoid later on clashes or collisions. Furthermore, data is one of the keys. So a seamless data integration from the beginning into our CFM system is essential, with compatible interfaces in the best way automated. You can generate a lot of savings in the operations later on. And then I want to show you our immersive VR experience application. So this is based on our 3D model from our warehouse in the Netherlands. So we use it in general for communication, for easy decision making, to onboard new talents on our topics, as well as a digital warehouse experience in general. And what came In the last year with Corona, we included as well crowd flow simulations. So we could simulate the access and the people flow, how they get access to the building and simulate different scenarios. So on that point, we could ensure all the health and safety regulations in the building for our employees. And that's it from my side. Thanks a lot.
Yeah, from the building, we are now switching to the mobility. Mobility is also one of the key factors in urban life. So I welcome here Christin Bauer. He's the CCO of Volocopter. Yeah, Christin has 15 years experience in the mobility sector. He's been working with Daimler on different projects together with Airbus, MyTaxi, HERE Technologies, and others. He was responsible within Mercedes-Benz for the Department of High-Tech Corporations and to push innovations in series and make them work. And now he's making urban air mobility services and as an integral part of transportation systems. Happy to have you here, and maybe we can see also what is Volocopter making at the moment.
Thank you, Steffen. Sure. And with that, please, I've brought a short video to show a bit what we are doing. So what our mission is really we want to bring electric flights into the urban environment, into the city center. So we are an air taxi company based in Germany. And we want to add a new transportation mode to the city, to the urban life, to connect the buildings that we have seen. And we started very early, already 2011, where we had the famous yoga ball video that you have just seen, where we lifted up a person fully electric. We have done flights in Germany with permits, in Dubai, flying fully autonomous, and also flights all over the world, be it in Singapore and also Helsinki and the like. And what you see very often, it's a hot topic right now, urban air mobility, electrification there, but a lot is on paper. We actually do it and fly, as you see on our flight fields. So in the future, you can imagine a new access to transportation for people living in the urban environment, as 68% of the world population will live there. There will be congestion on the ground. It will be very also investment heavy to build new roads, or if there is no space, so it gets to the third dimension. And how will that look like later for you as a customer, let's call it? You want, maybe you're in a city, as you see here in the video, you want to commute from A to B. You simply take out your mobile phone and as with My Taxi or as with other apps, you will book your flight. Then you transition to what we call the Voloport. By the way, this is an actual picture, no rendering. We built up this beautiful infrastructure in Singapore 1.5 years ago as a prototype to show to the world how also takeoff and landing sites for those electric air taxis can look like. Then you check in, you get into your Volocopter, and then you hop off. And what is the beauty about that? Electrification here means it's safer, it's 100 times safer than a classical helicopter, so it's as safe as an airline. It's also sustainable in flight, and it's also sustainable when you look at the noise profile. So our vehicle is very silent. You can compare it rather to an air conditioning than, you know, a really loud helicopter around. And of course, it's built for business travelers, so you arrive at the airport, transit to the city, but also for tourists who want to experience a great livability in a city and to commute from one spot to the other. This is our now series product. It's called the Volo City, which we are in series production right now entering. And this product has a high redundancy in its system. So it's fully electric. It has 9 battery packs that suspend 18 motors. So if we lose 1 or 2 motors, it doesn't matter, we can still safely perform the mission. When you are in a helicopter and the gasoline, let's call it engine, doesn't work, well, you have a problem. This is our new beauty. It's called the Volo Connect, because the Volo City will cater for 35 kilometers And we just announced that 4 weeks ago. It's VoloConnect. It's a four-seater product. We have already a scaled version of its test flown. And this will connect to around 100 kilometers for the metro or city-to-city environment. So with those family of aircraft, we are really ready to bring a new service to the city and the urban environment for commuters, for business travelers, or for tourists. And last but not least, because we talked about Zalando, we talked about warehouse, we also have another product which already has flown, and I think we'll also exhibit it tomorrow somewhere in Berlin, spoiler. This is the Volo drone, which is the heavy lift cargo version. It's big, it's 9 meter diameter, and it can lift up 200 kilogram to bring also sustainable logistics to the inner city center. So with that, our DNA is being a pioneer as Volocopter, and we also want to be the pioneer to bring electric flights into the city. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Christian. Now we had the building, we had the mobility, and now we'll lay the third thing on top. So welcome here Tanja Kufner. She's an expert in startup, she's very interested in smart transport and energy. I think transport we already had, but energy, this is what we have the main focus even in the last decade. She's recognized annually as one of the top 50 most influential women in venture capital, and she brings also something new with her. She's now together with Nemetschek, working for Nemetschek, the design and construction software company. And I think with that experience, we will hear more about digitization and maybe startups.
Thank you very much, Steffen. Would you mind handing me the clicker,
sure,
just in case I want it? Oh, I wasn't going to show that yet, but this will explain very much what I'm thinking about these days. So thank you for the intro. Christian and I actually, interestingly enough, go way, way back. When we started looking at investing in mobility startups about 15 years ago. And I have been thinking very much about sustainability. So one of the things I did when it was not very cool in 2014, I built an accelerator program around aerospace, around logistics, around mobility in the sense of automotive, and lots of different corporates, and we started looking at the future of urbanization and the future of cities. Basically looked at scouting technologies and startups from around the world. And interesting for me, I feel like if you look at the five largest drivers in carbon, and we're looking at trying to clean up our cities, and what do cities look like, obviously, you know, transport and mobility is probably one of the most important ones. And then, I don't know how you guys spent Corona, I actually had nothing to do. So I had about a year and a half to spend a lot of time with the European Commission on investing money for the Green Deal. So next to all the mobility solutions that, in my opinion, a lot already exists. It's in everyone's mouth. We're on in a great way. We have a lot of obstacles to overcome, but many solutions exist now, and that's phenomenal. And I think there's a lot of other industries that we need to think about when we look about, you know, urbanization. How do we clean up these cities? And then a friend of mine said recently, she's like, Tanja, if your grandchildren will look at the planet one day and they'll look at a city from the top, it will look completely different. And I said, yeah, I hope so. It'll be greener and it'll be different. And then she said, but you know who will actually be responsible for all that? It'll be the construction people, which I thought was really interesting. I'd never thought about that. So anyway, during Corona, we invested the Green Deal in a lot of energy transition startups. But then I looked at an opportunity where I think, and I think if we can maybe just quickly go through this picture says 1,000 words. This comes from a new fund that sits here in Berlin and in San Francisco called Foundamental, and they're basically a venture capital fund that specializes in prop tech and construction tech. And this story says words. If we look at mobility technology, the inflection point from when a company first raises $5 billion in investments to raising $10 billion in investments from venture capital, there, you know, there's not an inflection point, but then there's a jump to 20 million and 50 million. You can see that mobility had its core sort of 2014, 15, 16. And then travel, hospitality, you look at logistics, started a little bit later, and then you look at prop tech. And so most recently, and it's actually not even 2 weeks, I found a great company, and the company found me in a company called Nemetschek, and they are a very strong software company in the planning and building and designing of buildings, but then also in the construction technology. And there you can see that that is an industry that is still extremely, I'll say it, dirty, and needs digitization. And as you earlier pointed out, Steffen, it just produces so much carbon and so much filth and so much waste. And so I take it upon myself to learn a new industry, and I'm super excited to raise a venture capital fund where we get to invest in a lot of these construction tech companies. So basically that's a little bit to my history, but I don't know if we want to talk about the data. But as you already pointed out, basically construction affects about 41% of its annual global CO2 emissions, which is crazy. And it gets even worse, because if we think about the popularization or urbanization of this planet, if we carry on like this, we're going to drive 230 billion of square meters of new construction in the next 40 years. I mean, that's insane. Right? So obviously we need to think about how we design, how we engineer and build not just new cities, but new infrastructure. I won't get into R&D figures, but trust me, this industry needs disruption. But more importantly, I can't wait to hear a little bit more about what you guys think about where the innovations lie and where you, you know, in all the histories of cities that I've looked at, why do we go to Singapore? You know, why is this stuff not happening in Munich? But I'm sure Steffen has a lot of great questions for us, so I'll be quiet.
So, good to have you here. I would say let's start from the scratch. We have a new idea of building a headquarter. So, Christin, you already did it for Zalando. So I think if you look in the last decades, we often forgot the people who have to live, to work in these buildings. So, how have you been started within Zalando? There was just the need of a few more square meter, and then you order the architect, or how was the process?
So if we're talking about people, so in Zalando, we always have the people in the center. So everything we're doing is for our internal customers, so our employees. So in general, we're really have a strong diversity and inclusion strategy in Zalando, and everything we do, if, for example, at those times with new work and how the future of work will look like, we have as well a full work stream just for people and culture. So it has no sense if we just talk about on-site experience or remote digital experience. We just have to have always the people in the center.
And therefore, it's also important to have a focus on mobility, because you have also only the responsibility for the building, and mobility is often not, it comes from the state in most of the cases. Have you maybe worked together with Christian to think about his solutions, not even the people, also in the warehouse system? Is mobility a case you're looking at?
Yeah, we never worked together, but I think we will in the future. So
very good.
yes, for sure. Mobility is one of our core competences or key topics. So we're going step by step as well here in regards of testing. So we are creating complete mobility concepts, including all the sustainability initiatives. Because then it makes more sense. For example, we're experimenting at the moment with carport solution on the top with PV, and have electric charging stations under it. As well, we're doing some experiments with hydrogen. So it's a big topic in Zalando.
Christian, if you are in discussion at the moment, are these global corporates? Are these more or less the states, the local authorities? What are the discussions within Volocopter, and what will be the key for the future to get these things done?
Yeah, I think the first point was really certification regulation. Airspace is highly regulated, right? And we are having the approach first, talk to the regulators, to the city before you enter a city, because if not, it's gone. But I think the good thing is, on European level, the legislation has been made for air taxis. Now it's on us to develop that and to bring it to final certification where we are right now. So that's our internal hurdle right now, and we're in a good way. The second thing is then, and I think it's really amazing, I think 4 or 5 years ago, people were, what is that? Urban air mobility. Now really the cities and partners are coming to us. So we are right now have to prioritize which city, where do we go, and so on, because yeah, maybe it's a bit hyped right now, but that shows also a lot of investments are going into that sector. A lot of players are there, so the market is coming. And around those discussions, I think every city has on their agenda smart mobility and sustainable mobility, mobility, right? So on the building side, but also on the transportation side, we see that all over the world. And there are some examples like Singapore, who always strived for sustainability, also in their building, how they do that. And there are cities which are catching up. And I think as a centerpiece, you know, that's the slogan of this whole conference, celebrate the change. It's about starting, showing, and others follow. And we have seen that with big corporates, so also in our industry, we are starting something, and now also Airbus, Boeing are bringing out electric planes and so on. So I think it's all about starting, even though it's not 100% perfect, and then bringing it to the next level.
We have seen also in your video, there's a lot of cities. I've seen Dubai, but also German cities as well. Where's the pressure at the moment? Is it the US or the Asian market, or where's your watch list number one?
Yeah, I think right now, that's what we stated also publicly, we are a European company, we want to fly first in Europe. Okay, so we really want to do that. That's why we have partnered also with Paris, the Paris region. To make that happen, that's a great project. And in Asia, I think Singapore is a lighthouse nation because they are quick, they can implement their forward-thinking, innovative, and then others can adopt. When you talk about market demand, 45% or 40% will be in Asia for that market, 30% in US, Latin America, and the remaining in Europe and the rest of the world. It's for me always amazing when I also go to China and look at that, discovering new 10 million cities I've never heard of, right? And I think this is something we have to understand with a decentralized German federation, yeah, with cities maximum 3.5 million. It's a difference when I go to a 10 million city, there are other needs than in a city that has 500,000.
Tanja, we saw your impressive slide about the investments in sustainability. You're also familiar with startups or in our construction sector, prop techs. Mm-hmm. What is your feeling there? Do we have a strong demand in Germany or Europe? Or do you see other regions, as Christin said, the Asian market or the US market, which will be forefront? Or?
So it's early days for me in this new sector, but from what I hear from some of the funds that are helping us out, there is very interesting technology in Asia, and very few of the funds actually have access to that, and we learn a lot from our friends at Foundamental. I personally think because of SoftBank and the recent bust, we had a WeWork in the construction scene, a very similar type of SoftBank investment. Maybe you know what I'm talking about. But I do believe at the moment the US is probably a little bit ahead of the game. But it's always like that, right? So I think in Europe we'll see interesting startups. There are so many already that are currently looking for funding. I think the interesting question is more about how early and how easy will adoption be in an industry that is just so non-digital, right? So this has been for many industries the same. So the question is more, how can we make it more efficient? And I think cultural adoption will be interesting. Yeah, because it's just an industry, from my understanding, that just has not worked digital at all.
Yeah, I think if you're coming to a construction, then we live in the last decade or in the last century. Of course, it's not everywhere bricks on bricks. We have now glass, wood is coming as well. But if you have a look, we heard a lot about technology, digitization. You're in the technology sector, and Christine told us about BIM, building information modeling. Does it make everything better, or is this the solution for sustainability in the construction sector? What about your thoughts?
Are you looking at me? So my thoughts?
In
general.
If all of you, I think, as you already mentioned, it's just bringing a new software for design and construction, or?
I think maybe just starting, first of all, we have through Lyft now, hopefully, and hopefully there will not be another waves, extreme scenario the last 1.5 years. This will change our living patterns and working patterns. So that's one thing. So I'm also curious to see what's happening. I think also in our company, we are now saying X percent of fixed desks, the rest home office from, and we have seen this works, right? Let's see how this goes on and what that means for the cities. Mm-hmm. Secondly, I see what you also said, Christin, that we make it more people-centric, so the city is more livable. That's the second thing. And globally speaking, I think the big real estate companies have seen that and pushed that, but construction, at least as a non-construction guy, what I learned takes time. In planning and so on and so on. And so you have to bring now these new strategies into the general planning premises of the authorities of the countries. And when it's in there, then it will come and take time. And there are first airports showing they are CO2 neutral. Yeah? For example, Rome has shown that. And there are other companies really pushing that. I think this will come. But again, also after now this extreme 1.5 years, we will also see what new patterns come out.
If I may add to that, I think if you look at sort of the value chain of building, and you look at planning and design, that's always been very software-driven, right? BIM has been around forever. I would love to ask you which BIM you're using, and if the answer is the wrong one, I'm going to have to take you outside. No, but seriously, I think that's been digital, right? Software-driven, and then there's the part in the middle that's the complicated part, the construction part, that's just not very digital yet. And then you look at sort of, you know, managing buildings, and there we see more IoT investments, and that's also going more and more digital. So I think within the value chain, there are sectors that are more advanced than others, I think. Yeah, we'll see. It's a billion-dollar industry, and there's a lot not just to do good in, but also I think even just efficiencies. It sounds crazy. I love looking at LiDAR and autonomous vehicles, and now we can put them on construction sites, but in reality, somebody said to me, if you want to do really good, all you have to do is make it slightly more efficient. And that seems so crazy to me because there's so much waste and inefficiency in this particular industry. So that's interesting.
Christine, how are you dealing inside Zalando with the own people? If you're implementing such software solutions and new ideas, I think you have to also do the change management.
Yeah,
and your partners as well. If you're going into construction, you have external partners. So the people on site, how are you dealing with that?
Yeah, that's what I wanted to add as well. So I think the weakness is not any more technology, or that it's not possible that we can achieve different goals along the whole entire life cycle. The problem is to get everything in the minds. So I think change management is one of the key topics here. So if we talk about our employees in the offices or our own employees, we are not forcing them to use something. So for example, Christian mentioned desk sharing, etc. So when it comes to those topics, we're not forcing them. We make it so nice that they see the added value and love the benefit, and they use it and adopt it automatically.
I think I would also be curious, you know, what about the, next to digitalization, what about the materials you mentioned, Steffen, you know, are there sustainable materials? Will we build up a building which has the purpose to be there for 10 years? And then, you know, you can reuse it. So what about that? And I think there are some companies I see also in the architectural side getting up, because also interesting for us, for our hubs and ports and so on. So I think this is coming, and this would be also interesting to see that. What's the purpose and how long is the purpose? In German, you would say Bausünden. Yeah. So what are you doing when you build something for 20 years and it just looks so ugly and is not necessary anymore, right?
Yeah, I fully agree. I see also in the future, material is one of the key factors. Because if you're dealing with construction companies, then you just tell them, these are my design and let's get started. And there's nearly nothing about sustainable material, about a circular economy or something like that. And I think there we have to change.
I think I'm not to pitch our European Commission, but I do think they do a fantastic job. And I think part of the problem that startups and innovations generally have here in Europe is that so much of the deep tech hardware, similar to what you guys build, it'll take at least 2 years for certification and nobody will fund you. So we call these things non-bankable, right? So then at least you have grants from the European Commission that'll invest up to 15 million per technology that needs certification. But to be honest with you, during the Green Deal, when I sat at home during Corona, I did all 5 investment rounds. And we invested in the most interesting materials for buildings. We did, you know, new beton, how do you say, new cement that sequesters more carbon than ever before. Or in weird sort of glass material that has mini mirrors in it that will, you know, basically change the color and do energy, smart energy management. So there's so much interesting stuff out there. Sadly enough, it sometimes just is not fundable because of these long roads to certification. But
we also talked about data. You said in your introduction, data is key. You know, as we have seen, you have also warehouses, you have offices. Do you have an overview? And what about data? What I see it, which is quite normal, that we have protocols or something like that. They are still handwritten in some of the sites. That a lot of global companies do not even know what they have as assets. There's nothing in their CAFM system or something like that. So how's it within Zalando? And what's your opinion where the way will go in the future?
I think, as I mentioned, so data is the key. So to generate transparency or to convince people and take them on the journey of the change, it's really important to know what you're dealing about. So data, so for example, building information modeling is one of our keys because you can include consistent the data in along the entire life cycle. So this is really important, yeah.
I'm always impressed about other sectors, for example, the automotive sector or your sector as well. Do you think that maybe we can get also some out of your sector into construction? If I think about mobility hubs or something like that, if that's more influenced from others than maybe from the construction sector, if we think in real production cases, everything is made handmade. We do not have these clear processes as you have with the fields we have seen there. Do you think that could be an option? And second question to that, what about the mobility hubs? What's your opinion? How buildings or infrastructure will change? Will that be maybe a new asset class? We heard about office and warehouse, and could that be also an asset class?
I tried to start with the first question. So I think, as Tanja mentioned, I think there are industries like the medical and health industry, which will booming right now. And also on the construction side, it's so big and there are too many quick wins why it should not get to that level what you mentioned. So that's my strong belief. And we have the funds now, what Tanja mentioned, so the ESG, the sustainability funds, to fund that. So there, in the past, it was like, you do sustainability, nice, is it PR? No, now really, it's a branding if you do that, and you can ask for a premium on that. Okay, that reflects also that you invest into that. So I think this is on the commercial side, so I think this is coming. Mm-hmm. Yes, and think into the future now, coming to mobility or urban air mobility. Think about if you could have at your building, your tower, a new access to a route to the city center or to the airport. So you are in your office and you have a small helipad, and you know, okay, in 2 minutes, you will get picked up and fly away. I think now on two perspectives, for the customer, great, but also for the building owner, because he will say to his tenants, look, you have a new mobility option. And we had already discussions also with real estate partners that said, great, this offers me a new access, and I can also, let's call it, make it commercial for myself. So that's why I invest into that. I think you always have to find the balance, not to overcomplicate it. Yeah, not that everywhere is then those mobility hubs and so on, and nobody uses it. You have to run your math. You have to do the months, and it needs to be used. And last but not least, I think at the end, energy will be a big play, be it for electric vehicles. So there is already shortage out there. We have that famous example when you drive to Italy from Germany, Bavaria. I'm from Bavaria. Classical people are going to Italy in summer holidays in the past. So everybody is charging then in Austria. What happens to the grid in Austria and to the infrastructure? Is it breaking down? You also have to think really about that in the overall picture. But I think it's coming. I've seen it, and some will implement it faster, and some will take a bit more time. But as I said, I look to mobility hubs where you have an electric vehicle coming in, and on top of the building, there will be a Volocity flying you to the next level. Plus, on the ground, a Hyperloop bringing you then from Munich to Frankfurt. So really integrating public, new tech with land, new tech with air, new tech. Sorry, long speech.
No, perfect. So we have also something from the auditorium. First question, cooling in building with climate warming will produce a lot of CO2. Which projects do you do in these sectors, and are new technologies needed? So maybe you've developed also something in your warehouse about cooling.
Yeah, we're experimenting at the moment with Fiesmann together to implement, or we're already implementing, an ice storage. And that could be a good solution, yeah.
Yeah, thank you. We have also to go new ways and not even think about insulation. I think this is the old way, and most of the actual insulation is the waste of tomorrow. So we have to think which energy is needed, and to reduce the energy which is needed. But on the other hand, we have a lot of energy. Just think about the sun, or think about groundwater or something like that. And there are new concepts coming. I think, as you said, there are some problems often with the regulation and the authorities, but we are on the way. And I think we have to change even in the heads that we are more flexible. There's not one solution. We have to check each building and then find the best solution out of it.
Yeah, and I think, this will all come. There are always new innovations, in my opinion. And then, they have a hype, then some die, and then it's implemented. I like the example always also of the electrical bikes, right? 8 years ago, electrical bikes it does not work. Now look to the street, 50%, 60% market penetration. Mm-hmm. And the same is with our, home energy storage topics. So I found it when I was in Mercedes-Benz Energy, home storage, solar. Yeah, you have then your own storage and you can use it for air conditioning, peak hours, and so on and so on. And I think there again, it was a hype. Then nobody's so much interested, and then it will come to our homes, seamlessly, and we all will have it at the end. And I think this is also fascinating in that. So working with the topic air conditioning or something like that, you can do a lot, as you said, with solar power, energy storage already today, and it's affordable.
plant-based stuff. Some of the stuff we also invested in is new facade technology, right? Where you just green facades and so many cool things we can do.
The next question, what are your thoughts on the increase in CO2 pollution caused by server farms to support this digitization? I think a good point. We have that, that's an upcoming demand. And I know, are you owning your own data center within Zalando, or you have also external? I think we're doing within our company a lot of from these data centers, and I think also there are new solutions. Just think about bringing different asset classes together. For example, farming on the roof with the heat you're producing within the data center, then I think you have to think about where's the right location for the data center, not thinking just about the grid, but thinking about free flow cooling, not building that in Spain or where else, or you use the sun to cool down. So I think that's under development. And we will, we have to think about digitization is a game changer, even for sustainability in buildings.
Maybe this afternoon I have that, I have a panel with Kate Brandt, who's the chief sustainability officer at Google, and that's actually one of the questions I will ask her. So if we can't answer it right now, tune in at 5:30 and maybe we'll learn from Google how they solve that problem.
Then we're coming to a last round. So, Christian, in your opinion, what would be the first city where we see the commercial use from Volocopter in a real base case that people can order by app? What's your thinking at the moment? What will be the first city or region where we'll really feel that, not only as a prototype, but really in use, and people are happy to have a new mobility solution?
So first of all, and you will laugh now, it will be Bruchsal, Germany, because we will have our test center there, and we are committed there also to, you know, to do our R&D and things there. From a bigger city, I see high chances with Paris. Yeah. Watch maybe the news next upcoming days. Yeah. Also on the Asian market, Singapore is front running there. Again, but the race is on. So that's also up to the public. If you here is a mayor or someone of a major city, please contact us. You can still surpass the others. But again, those regions I just mentioned will be the first. Obviously, US is speeding up. With the new legislation they have right now, they are pushing the topic also. So I think East Coast, West Coast will strongly push into that direction.
Then, Christin, we have seen over the last 1.5 years that even a lot of your colleagues stayed at home. So will they come back? And is there still the need of so much office? Or how your buildings will change in the future, even the warehouse and the offices?
I think mostly the work style will change. So, we at the moment we have three of open buildings open in Berlin. So, we have around 10% could come to the office, and there is not a big need at the moment because it was really seamless. We're a tech company and it worked really well to bring everybody at home. And now we're more working on the connection, how you build the culture between being at home, some people being in the office. And we didn't finalize yet our hybrid model, but it will lead definitely to a hybrid model. Yeah.
Tanja, stop. Yeah, it's only the last question.
Okay.
Just a short one, because you are now switching from speaker to moderator.
Yes.
What about startups and prop techs? As you already mentioned, the European Union brought new things on the way. Do we see there more investments in the future to bring even design and construction forward?
Absolutely. I mean, there's, like we said, you know, we have yet to hit the 10 billion venture capital funding in that market. We're at 8 billion at the moment, which is still early days, but we expect the 10 to 50 billion in the next 2 to 3 years.
Yeah, then thank you. Urban sustainability, I'm quite sure we are able to make a two-day conference or more, but time is over now. I hope we brought some new interesting ideas on the table. Thank you to my speakers. Thank you for listening, and take care. Thanks.
Thank you. Thanks,